Empowered Homes is more than a website. It is a tool to connect church and home, to grow strong families, to build strong marriages, and equip parents to be the primary faith trainers in their homes. The purpose of these resources are to empower you and your home to be transformed by the power of the gospel. Resources for the good days and the bad, to keep fighting for your own heart, for your marriage, and for your kids.
Welcome to our online worship experience. If this is your first time, we're so excited to have you with us today. In just a moment, our worship band will lead us in a couple of songs, and one of our teaching pastors will lead us through a passage of scripture to help us all grow to become more like Christ. Before we get started, we would love the opportunity to get to know you better. If you've never filled out a connection card in person or online, would you text the word connect to 797979? This will send you a brief online form where you can share some basic contact information, allowing our team the opportunity to reach out to you this week. Our ministry is so much more than just the online experience, and we'd love to help you get better connected to all we're doing as a local body of Christ. At this time, we also want to encourage each of you to like this video. Every time we get a like or a comment, our engagement increases, which leads YouTube to push our content out to more people. A simple like on this video and a subscription to this channel goes a long way towards making sure more people hear about the hope found in Christ. As we enter into a time of worship, I'd like to encourage everyone to seek God's help in focusing during the next few moments. Whether you've got children running around in the next room or your social media is just one click away, we want to invite God to help us tune in to what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our heart. Pray with me as we get started. God, thank you so much once again for drawing us together today digitally. We thank you for the technology that allows us to worship anywhere in the world. We pray for those enjoying this at this moment that you would help them connect with you, that you would draw them near to you, that they would sing out these songs of praise to you as a gift, and that your word would work powerfully in their heart as we open that up a little bit later. We love you, God. We thank you so much for your son. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Could carry that kind of weight. It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. You called my name, I ran out of that grave, out of darkness into your glorious day. You called my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Let's sing together. I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I need shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, and now your love is the air that of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I in the middle of the mystery.
Hey, church family. Thanks for tuning in to our online worship this week at the City Rise Network, West University Baptist Church, and Cross Point Church Bel Air, and our soon-to-be City Rise Missouri City campus. Each week, we take a minute and we just pause in our worship through singing and in our worship through the Word, and we want to worship by being generous and giving back to God. And so we just want to take a moment right now to do that. I just encourage you, wherever you are, wherever you find yourself, to just pause and reflect on the generosity of God in your own life. And as you do that, let that just stir you to worship. Let that stir you to even greater generosity as you simply worship the God who has sent His Son Jesus to save you, to give you new life, and to give you a new heart. And let that spur you through giving. Thanks for being so generous. And let's get back to worship now. Let's pray. Father, thanks again for being the author of generosity. We love you because you indeed first loved us. And God, I pray that as we give, as we write checks and as we give online or give in other ways, God, we ask that you use all of these funds and all of this generosity through giving to fund your kingdom, because we want to see it come. And we want to lift our city in the world by generously giving the gospel. We love you, Father, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
shall come with shout of acclamation and lead me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
Good morning. We're so thankful that you're here today worshiping with us. Today's reading is from Matthew 5, verses 21 to 26. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and be judged to the guard and be put in prison. Truly, I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny.
You have heard that it was said, you shall not murder.
But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment.
The time has come to reset.
It's time to reset.
Hey, it's good to be with you today. Welcome to our online worship experience. My name's Roger, and it is a joy to spend some time with you today. If you have your Bible, we're in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, we're looking at our second of eight installments of what we call Lessons from the Mount, looking at the Sermon on the Mount and Jesus teaching there. I'd love to lead us in prayer as we begin, so join me in prayer. Lord, thanks for today. Thank you for these who are tuned in. Lord, for the way you're going to use this message, we pray your hand upon it, your blessings on it. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to our lives. We lift up our nation. We pray for those that have been ravaged by this storm. Father, our hearts are heavy for them. Just based on what we've seen, our hearts are heavy for them. And so we pray your help and provision and restoration to them. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Father, we lift up our nation, this coming election. Peace in our land. We pray for protection against this virus, Lord, that you would remove it from our midst. We pray for those that we know who have it. Lord, would you touch them and heal them and raise them up? And Lord, you would just stop it in its tracks. That is our prayer. We turn our hearts to you. We pray that others would turn their hearts to you. And Lord, that they would find hope in this message and in our messages on our channel. We just lift our nation to you. We lift our neighbors to you, those who are suffering from this disease. We lift them to you. We thank you for our doctors, our nurses, our policemen and women, our firemen and women. Just pray your hand upon them, protection over them. Bless the proclamation of the word. May the word come forth and give us faith. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to dig into a topic that may hit real close to home. It's something each of us is going to have to learn to navigate at some point in our life, and it's the topic of anger. And Jesus, when he went about teaching and preaching and proclaiming the kingdom, he dealt with relevant things that everyday people dealt with. This is a topic, anger, that everyday people deal with. So let me ask you, has your anger ever gotten you into trouble? Probably got you into trouble for the very first time with your little brothers or little sisters, or your older brothers and older sisters. I'm the youngest of four, and I promise you, my anger got me a spanking or grounding at some point along the way. But then as you moved on from your family, as you were growing, it might have been your anger might have shown itself in school. And maybe out there at recess, you got into some sort of skirmish or mix-up or fight, and you ended up getting sent to the principal's office, maybe even suspended. I don't know, but that could be part of your story. Maybe guys, while you were playing football, someone gave you a cheap shot right as the whistle blew, and right in front of the referee, you retaliated because you were angry, and the referee throws the flag, and it costs you 15 yards. And then your coach benches you. And the next day at practice, y'all got to run. Y'all know the story, right? Because it happened to you, probably just like it happened to me out there on the gridiron. But then maybe, just maybe, you realized that your anger really needs to get under control, because with it, you hurt your husband, or with it, you hurt your wife. And you realize that your anger comes from a place of real pain. And you've heard me or others say, you know, it's hurt people hurt other people. This is something we have to address, something we have to dig into. Well, in today's installment of Reset, Lessons from the Mount, we're going to learn from Jesus as he addresses the topic that is so close to home in each and every one of us. And frankly, it's all over the place. As you look at life right now, if you're on YouTube or social media or watching the news, you are going to see picture upon picture, video upon video of just angry people. Jesus wants to deal with our angry hearts that we might live a different way, his kingdom way, the Messiah's way, the way of the kingdom of God. So let's look again at Matthew 5, 21 through 26. Matthew 5, 21 through 26, it says, "You have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you've paid the last penny." Now, before we break down this portion of Scripture, I'm going to give you two principles today. But before we do that, I want you to make sure you understand that Jesus here is the first of six, what scholars call antithesis statements. And he is going to say, you have heard that it was said. He's going to reference the law and a rabbi's teaching. But then he's going to say, but I say to you this. He's giving them the antithesis of this. And so this is the first of six of those installments in this lengthy discourse. Now, as Jesus does that, he is going to quote one or more verses from the Old Testament law. He's going to quote the law. And as he does that, you and I both need to understand he's not trying to do away with the law. He's trying to make sure he grabs the heart of the hearer, that they understand the heart of God. So what I want to do is I want to back up one section into Matthew 5, verses 17 through 20, and make sure we understand the heart of Jesus as he teaches on these principles from the law. Matthew 5, 17 and following. "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota or not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments," excuse me, "and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven." within this context of Jesus validating the law, validating the prophets, helping people understand God's heart, saying, I did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. He now addresses relevant topics. And he says, you've heard it was said this, but I tell you this. Now, remember, Jesus is proclaiming a new way, a new ethic, a new kingdom. And I want you to see, as we break down this passage that deals with anger, I want you to keep in mind these two big ideas. Look at these two big ideas this week. Number one, prevention over and against punishment. That's the first idea, prevention over and against punishment. Number two, reconciliation over and against religion. Reconciliation over and against religion. So let's look at the first. As Jesus is trying to deal with the heart, he is trying to lead us to prevention of our anger over and against punishment for anger. Notice what he says again, Matthew 5, 21 through 22. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. Notice there's a quote here and a quote here. So he's quoting Old Testament text. You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire. So in verse 21, we see this idea of punishment. Now, punishment or avoiding punishment can be a great motivator. Just ask any coach of athletes, as he would say, look, you do this and you won't have to run. Or if you're driving out on the highway or one of our roadways, you might come to one of these signs, one of these big orange signs that is noting a construction zone, and it says fines double for speeding. Here's your punishment. Here's the law. If you go over this speed limit in this section, because we have workers present, your punishment will be double the punishment that you might find for speeding in other places. See, the intent of the road sign is to tell you that if you break the law, you're going to have to pay a price. Now, notice here, Jesus is going to take us to two Old Testament verses. One is the sixth commandment. The other is then some punishment that is for that. So it's Exodus 20, verse 13, that says, you shall not murder. And then Exodus 21, 12, right, where it says you'll be liable to judgment. Well, here's what you're liable to. When you murder, whoever strikes a man so that he dies shall be put to death. The sentence for murder was death. And so that is the right punishment. That's what everybody's saying. Okay, yes, yeah, if you murder somebody, you're going to die. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, right? If you take a life, you're going to lose your life. But then Jesus says, wait a minute. You've heard that it was said these things, but I tell you this. I want you to see a much bigger problem. I don't want to just deal with punishment. I want to take you to a place to understand where this comes from, that we might prevent it. We might prevent the whole issue, that we don't need to do the punishment if we'll learn to prevent it. And so he says, here's the bigger problem, and what I want to challenge you to do, that you might live the kingdom way. So what's the real problem that Jesus addresses? He addresses our anger. You've heard it was said this, but I tell you this. If you're angry, you've basically committed murder to your brother. See, Jesus is saying anger leads to murder. He's putting them on the same level. He's dealing with the heart issue. One writer says this, murder starts with anger like cool water in a pot that's being heated. Our emotions are like that water. Something sets us off and we begin to simmer. Problems continue to rise and our temperature gets bigger. A few little bubbles start appearing in the water and we begin to seethe, just like the water begins to steam a little bit. And then before long, the pot is shaking and it's too late. We strike out against someone. The water boils. The pot overflows. You know, this is what happened between Cain and Abel in Genesis chapter 4. Look at Genesis 4, verses 5, 6, and 7. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry and his face fell. The Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why is your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it. So in verse 5, we see Cain is sitting there and he's seething. He's very angry. He's stewing in his anger. And in verse 6, the Lord comes to him and says, hey, you got to deal with this, man. You can't let this control you. It's trying, it's contrary to you, and it's trying to master you. You've got to own it. You've got to deal with it. And I think that's wise counsel for us today. Now, what happened to Cain? He didn't deal with his anger. And it led him to lash out, and it led him to violence, and it led him to murder of his own brother. He doesn't deal with his anger. It boils up and it spills over. And then we see he killed his brother Abel. All of this roots back to anger. And you may say, well, man, Pastor, I've never killed anybody. Great. Good. Good. But there are a lot of ways you can kill somebody and not kill them physically. There's a lot of ways you can use your words to tear down and destroy. Let me give you a few ways that we can actually really harm someone, even if we don't physically touch them. This is ways to kill. Number one, laugh at someone's hope and kill their future. Number two, mock someone's ambition. Number three, tell someone they'll never amount to anything. Number four, tell your kids that they are good for nothing and that they're stupid and worthless, and you will destroy them. Number five, withhold love and attention that sustains life, and you will tear someone down. You will destroy them. You will kill their inner person. Anger is a big deal to Jesus. Let me say that again. Anger is a big deal to Jesus. And what he does next is he grabs us by the throat saying, this is so significant. I need you to understand it. It's what Tim Keller calls a three case studies that Jesus puts before his audience. Look at verse 22. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire. Three case studies that really to us, they don't seem all that significant, right? Because I've got brothers and a sister and I've been angry with them and they've been angry with me. Have you ever been angry with your siblings? Yes. Yes. You know, there's a scripture in Proverbs that says a brother was born for adversity. And I read that sometimes. I'm like, okay, to stand with me when adversity comes against me, or a brother was born for adversity because that's where we learn to tangle a little bit, right? And I think it's probably, yes, true in both situations. And so have you been angry with your brother? Yes, me too. I have too. How about calling someone an airhead? Have you ever called someone stupid? In one translation, it says, you who say to your brother, raka. That's like calling them an airhead. So the ESV that I'm using doesn't use that terminology. But it's like you're calling someone stupid. That's essentially what raka is. You airhead, you stupid. You ever done that? Have you ever proclaimed something like this? Dude, you're such a fool. You idiot. Jesus, I mean, I'm sure his listeners are chuckling when he's using these illustrations. Like, hey, if you do this with your, oh yeah, you airhead, you fool. He says, hey, that's worthy of condemnation to the gates of hell. See, God is so holy. He's so set apart. He can't dwell where sin dwells. And the reality is we all have some sort of anger issue that we need to be willing to deal with. You know, Charles Spurgeon once said, do not say I cannot help having a bad temper. Friend, you must help it. Pray to God to help you overcome it at once, for either you must kill it or it will kill you. You cannot carry a bad temper into heaven. What's Spurgeon's point? You've got to deal with your temper. We studied this not too long ago as we looked at James' instructions to us in the series No Filter. We did a whole message on it. If you want to go back and see that, probably week two or three. But look at James 1, 19 through 21. Know this, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. We've got to deal with our anger issues. We've got to deal with that which leads to filthiness, to wickedness. And we do that by receiving the word implanted into us. We receive it with meekness, a harnessed humility. We receive the word. So how do we do this? How do we deal with the anger problem that Jesus identifies that is so destructive and worthy of our condemnation? First, we recognize that only He can help us. We've got to have His power, that He died for us and He rose again, and that yes, though a sinner, we can be saved by His grace. It's so important that we understand this. Before we look at this next principle, we've got to understand that we are all liable to judgment as He's proclaimed because we've sinned against our neighbor. We've sinned against our brother. We've called him a fool. We've called him an idiot. We've been foolish in this way. And only He can really help us. So we need His work on the cross, His death, burial, and resurrection. We've got to be saved by grace through faith. We put our trust in Him to save our souls. And then we say, Lord, would You help us? We want to live Your kingdom ethic out. We want to live Your way. We don't want to be a people who are caught up with, we don't want anger to be a place in our home. I tell my kids, hey, my house is going to be a place of peace, and I will fight you to have that peace. We're going to not have a place where it's just full of anger at one another all the time. We're going to be peaceful, and it's going to be a place of retreat. So what do we do? How do we do this well? What's the next principle we need to see so that we can begin to overcome this problem that is so prevalent in many of our lives and in many of our days? Here's the second principle, right? Two big ideas this week. The first was prevention over and against punishment, because it's about the heart. Same thing here, reconciliation over and against religion, because it's about our heart. Reconciliation over and against religion. Let's look at this principle here in Matthew 5, 23 through 26. So if you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put in prison. Truly, I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. The last few verses here, verse 24, 25, and 26, the offense is such that this guy's going to take you to court and it's going to cost you. And if you don't pay, you're going to have to pay with time. It's one of those kind of offenses. But I think the principle is significant here. The principle to us is that we've got to be willing, no matter how big or small the offense, to go and seek to be right with our brother. We've got to be willing to deal with our anger issues. And to do that, we go and seek forgiveness. We go and we seek forgiveness. So this section helps us see our need to seek this forgiveness from our offenses and to go and seek that out. Now, let's go back to James' words for a moment. And I want you to see verse 20 again. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. It sure doesn't. As a matter of fact, when I've been angry and I've acted upon it, it has produced chaos and it's produced pain, both in my life and in the lives of those I have hurt. Because anger disrupts unity. Anger destroys relationships. It tears down homes. Anger leads to alcoholism and drug dependency. Anger, unchecked, leads to violence and abuse. Anger leads to murder. It's a destructive force. And the problem that I see, and one that I've experienced, is how we just want to act like anger doesn't exist and it's not a problem. True story here. Remember, as a very young pastor, dealing with a parent one time, this parent engaged me to help with marriage and with his children. And I remember that they would call me, and anytime things went sideways, and it was at all sorts of hours. And I was young, they were calling me, I wanted to help them, and I didn't put up boundaries. And it just, I mean, my phone was ringing constantly. And I'm like, man, what is going on? What's going on with these folks? After a season of this, I realized, you know, this person has an anger issue. And I decided to confront them. They were coming to me for counsel, and I said, look, I'm going to just be honest with them. And so we meet at a restaurant. We're having some refreshments. We're talking at this point. I think we're maybe having coffee. And I just said, look, here's what I see. And I love you enough to be honest with you, and here's what I see. You get angry. You've got an anger issue. And it's always everybody else's fault, and you blow up, and that's creating chaos. Guess what happened? They backed away from the table, got up, said a few choice words to me, and walked on out of there. I mean, it was what I was saying, I was seeing. They were now directing it at me. It was everyone else's fault. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. And this is a true story. I'm like, what? Next time I saw him, it's as if nothing had ever happened. That's a picture of someone not willing to deal with the divisive nature of anger and the disruption it creates in everyone's life. See, to get a handle on our anger, you know what we have to do? We've got to own it. We've got to own it. We've got to seek reconciliation. We must humble ourselves and go to those that we have hurt with our anger and ask their forgiveness. We've got to make it right. It's reconciliation of relationship. That over and against religion. God doesn't want our religious practice if we're not willing to go reconcile. Notice what Jesus says in verse 23 and 24. So if you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. The message from Jesus is go and get right. Go and get right. Now imagine this. It's the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is talking to Galileans in the northern part of Israel, northern part of Palestine, near the Sea of Galilee. They would make their offerings at the altar in Jerusalem, southern part of the kingdom. They would walk on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. They would go down the Jordan River. They would come back over near the Dead Sea. They would come up through Jericho, and they would come up and ascend to Jerusalem three different times a year. They would go and make offerings. They would observe these religious offering holidays. And it's as if Jesus is saying, hey, you may be in Jerusalem offering a sacrifice and you get convicted. Don't do anything else until you go and find your brother and get right. They may be right there in Jerusalem with you and you find them and you apologize and you plead with them and you seek to be right. Or you may even have to come all the way back to Galilee. You can't phone them then, you can't text them then, can't email them then. You go seek them out, find them. You want to start dealing with your anger problem? Go humble yourself. The work and humiliation of humility and saying I'm sorry and figuring out the words to say, it's going to do a work on your soul. And you're going to do this a few times. You'll be like, man, this is no fun. I want to do whatever it takes to not have to keep doing this and living my life this way. But Jesus is teaching to this audience, and he's saying, choose reconciliation over religious observances every single time, because it's about the heart. And the gospel of Jesus Christ makes us right with God vertically, but also right with our neighbor, right? Because Jesus is saying, I didn't come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. And the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second like it, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Friends, we've got to tune into this. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Do we ever need this message today? We look at our neighbors as Democrats or Republicans, as liberals or as conservatives, as white or as black or as Asian or as this or as that. No. Stop. Quit. Love God. Love your neighbor. This is the way of Jesus. This is the ethic of Jesus. And they're worthy of your love because they're worthy of his love. He gave his life for them too. And if you're going to be salt and light, as we talked about last week, sometimes you know what you have to do? You got to shut your mouth, suck it up, and even humble yourself and say, I am so sorry. But really, it's those we live with the closest, that we spend the most time with, where we can often offer the most damage with our words, with our anger. If you want to deal with your anger issues, go to your loved ones and seek to get right. So what I'm going to do over the next minute or two is talk to you about how to live with a clean conscience. This is from Greg Simmons in his article, Leave Your Gift and Go. He's going to give us a 5-step process of seeking to live with a clear conscience. Here are the 5 steps. And I want you to consider these steps and any course of action you should take that might apply to your life, right? So you might want to begin with, before you even look at the 5 steps, you might want to begin with, hey, Lord, is there anybody I need to get right with? Would you show me? He'll show you. But notice these 5 steps. Number one, confess your sin to God and repent. Agree with God. That's what confession is, and turn from it. God, I agree that I have offended this person, that I was out of line with this person, that my words hurt him or hurt her. Please forgive me. Number two, seek forgiveness from those you have wronged. Seek forgiveness from those you've wronged. Listen, I said some things to you. I hurt you. I am so sorry. Would you please forgive me? Friends, when someone comes asking for forgiveness, it is right and proper to also extend that forgiveness. I forgive you. Proclaim that forgiveness. Number three, where necessary, make restitution for any damage you've caused. Where necessary, make restitution. Number four, where possible, seek to restore the relationships. Seek to restore the relationships. I remember Miss Barbara used to say, hey, the dog bites you once, it's the dog's fault. Bites you twice, it's your fault, right? And so at some point, you might say, hey, you're forgiven if someone's coming to you. Hey, I forgive you, but the relationship may be different. Because you don't want to get bit by the dog again, right? And so it's okay if you say, hey, I forgive you, and yet the relationship is never, ever the same. But sometimes the hardest conversations can actually lead to the most fruitful relationships. And so where possible, seek to restore these and grow upon them, make them better. Number five, go forward with a sense of urgency. Go forward with a sense of urgency. Why is urgency important? Greg Simmons states, urgency is important because an unclear conscience is hindering your relationship with God. The longer you wait to clear your conscience, the harder it will be to finally do the right thing. This is a high priority in the eyes of God, and it must be a high priority to us as well. Friends, the call of Jesus is a different way. It's so radical, it's transformative, and it challenges us in every way. But his heart for you is to live with a clean, clear conscience. His heart for you is to live at peace. So will you search your heart for this anger? Jesus wants to prevent this anger in our lives so that we don't have to pay the penalty. We don't have to pay the penalty and suffer the consequences. So will you search your heart for it? Also, will you search your heart for this need to reconcile? He longs for your reconciliation far more than your religious observance. So seek him now. Remember, at the very end of this Sermon on the Mount, he said these words, and I'll close with this. Matthew 7:24. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. May we hear his words, practice them, building our lives upon the rock. May our Lord bless you and keep you. May our Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May our Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Once again, if you're a guest, please text the word connect to 797979 so one of our team members can reach out to you this week. If you'd like more access to information and Christ-centered content, we encourage everyone to check out the video description for links to our social media accounts for the City Rise Network and each of our campuses. Additionally, please take a moment to subscribe to our YouTube channel and our Apple Podcast, linked in the video description below. Every like, follow, and subscription helps our message of the hope found in Christ gain more attention in the social media algorithms. So your help in building our audience is an easy way to help our ministry in our city and the world. Before we go, let's pray. God, thank you so much for what you did today in our hearts. As we worshiped, as we learned, as we open up your word together, would you continue to use what we just experienced to make us more like Christ as we go throughout our week? Help us to be used to lead others to you, to encourage others, to love our neighbors. Just use what we experienced today to make us more like Jesus. We love you, God. We thank you for your son. It's in his name we pray.